and they carry me down to my dying ground. Don't you weep for me when my time has come and I must move on. Don't you dare.
Well, I've actually been fascinated by death and dying since I was young. And I remember as being a young kid, and I had made up a will.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the realization was for me that people die, but I made up this will, and I didn't have very much, some baseball cards and pogs or something. But my granddad in England, his house looked over a cemetery, and I remember often going for walks as a child with my mother and my grandparents in England, and the tombstones there, a lot of them had photos, and I'd never had seen that before here. And so as a young child, I used to always stop at these tombstones and look at these photos and ask my mother or whomever to read me out the names and information of these people. And sometimes I used to bring a pencil and paper, and I would run my pencil over it and get the sort of imprint on the page. But at a young age, what I realized was that I didn't fully understand death. I sort of, in some way, believed that there were alive people and dead people.
Okay.
But not that people are once alive and then are dead, but that Sally Sue, born 1942, died 1985, once was just as alive as I am. There was this weird abstraction that was happening in that young mind that just didn't see or understand that dead people were not a separate species,
right,
but they were just what happens to alive people.
That's
so I think later in my life, when I came to that realization, it was when I first had my anxiety about death, and hence the making wills and stuff like that. But death, I think, has always made me extremely nervous.
Okay.
And yeah, I don't think I deal well with death. I mentioned to you earlier that I was at a memorial just a couple days ago, and I'm doing all the things one does to be helpful. I'm, you know, helping with the food and laying out, but I wasn't making the connection. I knew this person, I liked this person, but again, wasn't making the connection. And then as more people came, and people started to offer up testimony, and when her daughter, who's a close friend of mine, arrived, and I saw her face, and it sat with me a bit differently.
Yeah.
And it brought up all the stuff that I think that I struggle to look at in my daily life, which is how absolutely scary, and scary because it's an unknown event.
Yes.
Death is. And all of my life, I think, if I was to be fairly honest, all of my adult life has been in some way a resistance to the reality of death.
Mm.
So, you know, a friend in my late teens, early 20s, a friend was horribly murdered, and it completely pulled a rug from under me. I came to New Thought teachings as a teenager, and I was so coming from an adolescence and childhood where I really believed that the world was sort of like conspiring against me, right? Like I just, mm-hmm. it was one shitty thing after another. to come and to discover a teaching that had sort of, that was an empowering teaching, that sort of talked about a co-conspiring universe that works out for your good, and I was loving that, right? And so while I was in the midst of that high of those teachings, in my 20s, I must have been 20, this friend is murdered. And murdered in a circumstance that just didn't need to have been. And he was good. And he was nice. And the night he was murdered, I was supposed to go and stop by. I got caught up at work. And so there was also this part of me that I realized that, you know, one different choice and I would have been there too.
Yeah.
And I think that that was the moment where it could have been my realization that I'm really scared and death is real and it's unfair and it's inevitable. But instead, I think I did the opposite. So my 20s was a rat race, dizzying series of attempts to avoid the precariousness of like my humanity. Yeah. So I threw myself into career. I threw myself into relationships, sex, drugs, God. I tried for years to have kids because, you know, and yeah, and now as I'm older, I realize that I didn't sit with what his unnecessary and unexpected end brought up for me, which was life is chaos. Shit happens. It happens to everybody.
Yeah.
It's not fair. It just is. And it's inevitable.
Yes.
And it's out of my control. All of those things I think I wasn't able to deal with. And so I did what I literally did all the things that one might, you know, like food, sex, drugs, career, God, kids. Anything that will possibly prolong and extend this very finite, very insignificant little blip of a life that I know that I have and that I can't face, that it will come to an end. And so I'll become a preacher. And I'll talk about the everlastingness of spirit and a God of justice and fairness and order. And a universe of laws.
All sounds good, doesn't it?
Lullabies. And yeah. I tell myself, we're living on a planet that's spinning through a galaxy that is inevitably coming to an end. And at some point in there, I will too. And there's nothing that I can do.
Right.
And so death, yeah, I've had a very fear-based relationship with that notion of life and others.
Thank you.